Quote from the book on RFI, RFP process. The request for information, request for proposal process encompasses the preparation, dispatch and evaluation of supplier information and solicitations for offers. This is how you issue an RFI or an RFP today. In this video, I'm going to tell you how we did this in the 90s, and I'm going to talk about one key aspect that has not changed over all these years. Let's get started. You know that I started my career in procurement consulting back in 1995 with the team that had invented global sourcing with Ignacio Lopez. And at the very heart of global sourcing sat the RFI-RFP process. In those days, most companies worked with suppliers in the vicinity. German car makers would mostly use German suppliers and French car makers would predominantly rely on French suppliers. So global sourcing started with identifying potential new suppliers. I will talk about this in the video on A3, Supplier Market Intelligence. Once you had a long list of suppliers, you sent an RFI to them. The RFI explained what we were trying to do, so mostly offered the business of the client to a new set of suppliers. Then it explained the type of components we considered suitable for the supplier. And there was a table of specification ranges, and we asked the suppliers three key questions. First, do you have experience in making the specification range? Second, what are your references in the industry for our client? And third, are you interested in receiving an RFP? Then we spent days sending RFIs with fax machines. Of course, a lot of the fax numbers we had were wrong, so we had to call a third or so of the potential suppliers to verify the fax number or ensure that the fax machine was loaded with paper. After a couple of days, the interested and qualified suppliers would respond that yes, they would like to receive the RFP, and they denominated a contact person, which made communication a lot easier. But then the real hard work started. Assembling the RFP. The RFP consisted of at least a cover letter, instructions, bid sheets, list of parts in the RFP, and drawings and specifications for all these parts. Most of the content we could print ourselves, but for the drawings we had to rely on engineering to print and fold them. Then we assembled the RFPs, and this really looked like an assembly line. We often used the longest corridor in the client's building to do this. And we did this in the evening and in the night when the building was mostly empty to avoid people stumbling over the material we had laid out. For every supplier on the shortlist, there was a picking sheet. And with the picking sheet and the box, you started from the end of the line to the beginning so that the cover letter would end up on top of the box. Then you would seal and label the box and carry it to the mailroom. You would wait for a couple of days. When you believed the boxes should have arrived at the suppliers, you started calling the contact people. You explained the content of the RFP and you did your best to assure the supplier that this was real and a serious effort and not just a price benchmark. Of course, the manual picking process was error prone and more often than not, certain elements of the RFP were missing. And we did our best to fill the gaps by faxing what suppliers needed to come up with a good quotation. After 2 or 3 weeks, our fax machines would start running hot with quotations coming in. You would then double check the interesting offers to make sure that the suppliers had truly understood the drawings and specifications. And the results were absolutely mind-blowing. I still remember the incredulous faces of the procurement team and a car maker when we showed them the quotations for the exhaust system of the volume model. Several credible suppliers consistently offered to make the exhaust at the price 70%, at 70% lower than the incumbent supplier. We had many, many cases like this one. What took days of work 25 years ago can be done within seconds today. You have all potential suppliers in the vendor lists. The instructions for suppliers are sophisticated and user-friendly. And all the technical information needed to inform the supplier about the nature of the products is readily available at one mouse click. So everything has become a lot easier, but one thing has not changed. You still need to build a relationship with the supplier. You need to convince the key people that working on your RFP is a good investment of their time. And with the ease of issuing an RFP today, suppliers receive a lot more of them today than 25 years ago. So talking to suppliers, coaching them through the process, and being there for them when they have questions is even more important than it was when I was assembling boxes with drawings and specifications. So there you have it, E4 RFI RFP process, a purchasing chessboard method that has become almost entirely automated, but relies more than ever on you building relationships. Okay, now it is your turn. How do you ensure that your RFIs and RFPs stick out and get preferential treatment? Let all of us know in the comments down below. And should you have a question, I will get back to you within 24 hours. Thank you for watching, and I see you in the next one. Bye.